Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us continue in worship through song.
Still Easter, hallelujah. There were walls between us. By the cross you came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You call me out from the grave. You call me into the light. Call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Darkness shaking, all the dead are coming back to life. I'm back to life. Hear the song awaken, all creation singing, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light, you call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Oh, love, the love we found, it can't hold us down. We'll shout it out. Shout it out, 'cause we're alive, 'cause you're alive. Oh, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. Shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens. didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. And your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. The fear that held us now gives way to him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name, your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Watched in vain, was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Come on. Our God has robbed the grave. Praise will rise to Christ our King. ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. Would you come? Would you fill us? Would you form us? Jesus, we want more of you. Help our hearts to connect with you this morning. Help us to receive what you have for us. Break through everything that would distract or destroy and speak those words that only you know to draw us nearer to you. We want more of you, God. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Adults, you can be seated. And kids, if you would gather here up at the front for the children's, for the kids' blessing. And as they do that, let's sing our song of blessing over them.
Lord, here are your children. You know them by name. You call them to seek your face. Pour out your blessing. Draw them to you. Mold them and make them new. In this place is mercy and gladness. For me and my house, Lord, we will worship you.
Good morning, church. As I was thinking and praying about how to thank Christy this week, I was honestly at a loss for words. But I eventually, the word empower came to me. And the word empower means to strengthen and encourage. And Christy, that's what you've done for these kids. You've strengthened and empowered them and their parents and this entire congregation to know that we are loved by Jesus. So this morning, kids, we need to thank Miss Christy. Yes, we're going to pray a blessing of thanksgiving over Miss Christy, okay? Can you guys extend your hands? Almighty Father, thank you for Christy and the Penley family, for the way that she has encouraged and strengthened these kids, their parents, and our congregation to know the great love that you have for us. Lavish your love on her and her family through this transition. Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all that you have done through her. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you. Maddie, I got this picture. It has a mountain on it, and there's a little poem. And because sometimes ministry can feel like a mountain. It can be hard, but it's really beautiful. And I believe and I am excited for you to lead these kids. At the end of this thing, it says, be brave. And I want you to be brave in this role. Friends, I want to bless Maddie. So would you extend your hand as we bless Maddie? May you know that your Heavenly Father loves you. May you believe in your heart that you have been invited into His story and He has given you this role. As you use your gifts to lovingly serve, may your words be filled with love and grace as you invite others to experience the fullness of the love of God. May you be a Jesus storyteller and point kids and their families to Him. May you know that God is here. I pray that God would continue to open your eyes to see His work in and all around you. And may you know and never forget that He is with you. May you feel His presence, listen to His voice, and experience His love. May you know that God is mighty to save. And because of this, you never have to be afraid. May you trust in His goodness and walk in the faithfulness of what God has created you to be. May His goodness and grace continue to transform you into the image of Jesus day by day. And may many kids come to know, love, and serve God by watching your life and example. And may this community love you, support you, pray for you, in the ways that grow God's kingdom. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, kids, you get to follow Miss Maddie right out those back doors and go down to Kid Church.
Let us pray together. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let us continue in worship through the reading of God's word.
But you, Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, you descendants of Abraham, my friend, I took you from the ends of the earth. From its farthest corners I called you. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and have not rejected you. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Amen. The New Testament reading this morning is from the Epistle of Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known and evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Jesus, you are in our midst right now. And you speak to our hearts. You speak to us through your word. So I ask that through these words, you would bring good news. That even in the places where we are locked up, that you would come through our defenses and meet us. It's in your name, Jesus, that we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated. Well, friends, what are you afraid of today? What are you afraid of? Growing up, I was a pretty fearful kid. I was afraid of any food beyond bologna and ketchup sandwiches. I was afraid of swimming. I was afraid of asking for help. And I was afraid of Mr. Buck. Mr. Buck was a World War II vet and a dear neighbor. He lived right up the dirt road from us in Tennessee, and he had helped us on our family farm ever since my granddad had died when my dad was in college. Nobody called him by his real name. Even with his wiry frame, he was strong as a buck, and the name stuck. He rolled his own cigarettes with tobacco he grew himself. He didn't talk a whole lot, and he was extraordinarily competent with anything mechanical, all of which was terrifying to me. In reality, he was incredibly gentle and kind, but I wasn't mature enough to recognize that at the time. But as a result of my fear, I spent years trying to avoid working with just him. I would always hem and haw until my dad was available, or I'd find something else that needed doing at the time. I spent years trying to kind of navigate around, which is why I remember so vividly the day that I couldn't do that anymore. It was a sloppy, rainy day, and a key part of the electric fence that kept the cattle in had come unhooked from the top of our barn, and my dad wasn't around for whatever reason. I don't remember why. So it was just me and Mr. Buck. Unfortunately, we didn't have a ladder high enough to reach way up on the barn, so Mr. Buck had the great idea of putting a ladder on the back of a truck bed soaked with rain and having me hold it steady while he climbed up. Now, this was, of course, not a great idea. I was able to squeak out that I didn't think I could do it. I didn't think I could hold it, and he said softly, "You can hold it." I still remember his feet squeaking on the ladder, the whole thing kind of shifting under his weight, and my terrified brain just cycling through worst-case scenarios, right? I'm going to slip. He's going to fall. He's going to die. If he doesn't die, something worse is going to happen. He's going to be disappointed in me. He's going to yell at me. I'll be a failure. Something. Longest seconds of my life to that point. Until, of course, the seconds that followed those seconds, which I'll talk about later in the sermon, not right now, because for now, I simply want to welcome us into that place in our heads, that place in our hearts, those places where we are gripped by fear, where we can't escape what could happen, what might happen. I don't think those fears stop as we get older. I think sometimes we become a bit more adept at navigating them. Sometimes they change a little bit. Maybe we get better at medicating them or stuffing them down or protecting ourselves from them or putting up walls and locks to prevent them from getting at us. But those locks only work so well because even if what we fear is held at bay, the fears themselves inevitably end up breaking in, regardless of our best efforts. And we exhaust ourselves anticipating the worst, dreading all the things that might happen, that could happen. We become hamster wheels in our hearts, running through all the possibilities over and over and over and over and over again. Until eventually, graciously, God steps in. One of God's most consistent moves, one of the most predictable places of his presence is right in the middle of the fears that we feel like we are drowning in. We see that clearly in the story of the disciples gathered on that first Easter Sunday. They had been terrified that their Lord would be taken and killed by the authorities. When Peter first heard about it from Jesus, he railed against it, told him it wouldn't happen because he was afraid. That fear had come upon them and had been made true, but now an even greater fear was rising in their hearts. Because the whole goal of a disciple, the whole reason for being a disciple, was to become like the rabbi. It was the assumption baked into the very fabric of the relationship. So when Jesus was placed on that cross, they knew what was next. They knew what was coming. They were next. And they were terrified. So on Easter Sunday, they all, except for Thomas, who we'll talk about next week, regathered together, but only as they locked the door behind them. Because the Gospel of John says that they were afraid of the Jewish religious leaders. The disciples were scared. They were anxious about what might come next. So when they gathered, they took precautions to keep everyone else out. They took precautions to make sure nothing else bad could happen to them. Just like we often do in our hearts. They hunkered down, I'm sure, running on that hamster wheel in their heads to start the hard work of figuring out what was next. Until what was next walked into the room. John 20, verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Okay, side note at this point in the narrative, right? Jesus' resurrection body is weird. It's absolutely physical, absolutely continuous with the body he took into the tomb. Even the wounds are still there. But it's different because those wounds are now signs of victory. Now he can go through locked doors and walls. We don't understand how this works, what it exactly means for us and our resurrected bodies we'll one day have. We don't know what all that means, but we do know what it meant to the disciples. Jesus is back. This is amazing. And we probably don't have to die. It's got to be one of the reasons they're overjoyed, right? It's one of the things Jesus is addressing with his greeting, "Peace be with you." Right, that's directly addressing that fear of the locked door. "Peace be with you" was a typical Jewish greeting. Still is a typical greeting in both Jewish and Islamic cultures, actually. But to hear it on the lips of Jesus twice in this little short encounter had to have carried a different weight than just a typical greeting. Now to us, peace just means the cessation of hostilities, right? Peace in Ukraine would be Russia stopping, for example. But the word shalom, the Hebrew word underneath Jesus' greeting of peace, is a whole different animal. Shalom points to a fullness, a wholeness, an abundance, life the way it's meant to be lived. Not just bombs ceasing, but gardens flourishing, you could say. "Shalom be to you" was a declaration, a blessing that on the lips of the resurrected Jesus was pointing them toward an abundance that he was currently experiencing, but that they could not yet fathom. And on the lips of Jesus, it wasn't just a greeting. Those words had power to accomplish what they meant, just as all of Jesus' words do. So in the midst of their fear, in the midst of their anxiety, Jesus shows up and invites them, covers them in a true and a real shalom. Because there's nothing to fear, right? This is the point in the sermon on this passage where the preacher would typically say that now on this side of the resurrection, there's nothing to be afraid of, that resurrection hope drives out all fear, that we never need fear anything at all, and if you do, it's because you don't believe in Jesus enough, making all things new. Yeah, not really. Fear is an emotion, a good emotion, that God gave to us. Now, yes, fear can grow beyond its intended bounds. Sometimes anxiety can grow to crippling levels because of life experiences or biological triggers that require therapy or medication to help control. But fear in itself is not bad or wrong on either side of the resurrection. God gave us fear to help us protect things of value, to help us protect things that are most valuable, like ourselves and the ones we love. To discard fear completely would be to ignore our value and the value of those around us. There are things worth being afraid of because there are things that have real value. But this mantra in the scriptures, we heard it in Isaiah, we heard it in Philippians, of do not fear, do not be anxious. It's that flip side of peace be with you. That often gets twisted into a tactic to shame those who fear something different than we do. It was trotted out a lot during the pandemic, mostly as a weapon against those concerned about COVID. Don't be afraid of a virus. God's in control. Don't be afraid of death. It'll come when it's time. Now, the other side, of course, could have easily trotted out, don't be afraid of the government. Don't be afraid of scientific findings. Don't be afraid of inconvenience. God's in control. And there were and are good reasons to be afraid of the virus and of overreaching governments and of letting scientists make ethical policy. Right? All those can destroy extremely valuable things. But when Jesus says, peace be with you, he's using it quite differently than the ways we've recently used don't be afraid. He is not trying to shame them for their fear or shut down their very natural emotion. He is giving them resources to guide them through their fear. Because his resurrection doesn't mean that what they fear most won't come upon them. The resurrection is not a path around what they fear most. It is a power that is available to them in the midst of what they fear most. Let me say that again. The resurrection is not a path around what they fear most. It is a power available to them in the midst of what they fear most, because what they fear most is still coming for them, regardless of locked doors. John 20, verse 21. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. He wants them to get that. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. Okay, so he repeats his greeting, and then he renews their call to discipleship. Again, remember, the job of a disciple was to become just like their rabbi, and throughout his ministry, Jesus had been clearly telling them again and again that he was sent from his Father, that he could only do what he saw his Father doing. So now he makes their discipleship plain. As the Father sent him, he is sending them. Now, those sendings are obviously not identical. Each of the disciples is going to die for the sins of the world. But there is an imitation here. As the Son was called to become incarnate in human flesh, their ministry will be incarnational, gritty and intimate. What he taught, they will teach. As he healed, they will heal. As he loved, they will love. As he forgives, they will forgive. And as he suffered, they will also suffer. He is telling them that what they most fear will come upon them. because that door will not be able to hold back those who reject or misunderstand, those who want to hurt or harm or injure. No lock will be able to hold back what they most fear. It will come no matter what. In fact, all that lock will do is keep them locked in. See, locks not only keep the outside out, they keep the inside in. And if that lock stays shut, they won't be able to follow their rabbi into a world that needs rescuing. They won't be able to be sent as he is sent. So Jesus, in these moments, is telling them, he is recognizing their fear, and he is telling them, don't run from it. In fact, maybe even run towards it. He's telling them to stop locking the door to death and poverty and rejection and misunderstanding and to embrace those as inevitable in a life of following Jesus, where his mission is to bring the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven, and where that mission is being pushed back upon by the world. He's telling them, go, because there is an abundance that will be available to you within that fear. There will be, as Philippians says, a peace that passes understanding. But it will not be a peace that the world knows how to give, a peace the world can give, or a peace the world even wants to give or receive. It's something different entirely. John 20:22. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. What is the content of this peace? What is it that he's giving? We want a peace that is the cessation of hostilities. We want a peace that is a cessation of our inner wrestling. We want a peace that will conquer those we fear, that will actually get rid of the thing we fear altogether so we don't have to fear anymore. But that's not what he's offering. Shalom, as Jesus is describing it here, is an abundance emerging in the midst of the inner wrestling, in the midst of the things we fear, because he gives us a spirit that builds our faith, our hope, and our love, a spirit that builds in us joy, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. He gives us a spirit that gives us consistently, persistently, ongoing, the character of Christ. And friends, Christ was afraid. Gethsemane shows us that. But the difference is he was able to walk through that fear. That fear did not control him because it lived alongside the reality of his trust in his Father. And if you want to think about it this way, was tamed by trust in his Father. And also by his love for others. That's why Jesus highlights this gift of real forgiveness. Right? We don't want the power to forgive. We want the power to conquer. We want the power to take out whatever it is that is making us afraid. But the world has that kind of power, and all it does is create more and more and more fear. We have a power the world doesn't have. The power to bring reconciliation where no reconciliation exists. The power to stop the cycle of violence and to lay down our swords. To be able to utter, we have the same power that Jesus had on the cross to say, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. Now, when we exercise that power, what we fear may not dissolve away. In fact, we'll probably just get taken advantage of more. But in being able to say that, there's this abundance of soul, this breakthrough of the kingdom of God into our lives that sits alongside our fears and keeps us from being controlled by them. That keeps us from reacting in ways that would make others fear us. Because this is what the resurrected Christ is offering us. The ability to participate in a kingdom where the worst that can happen will still happen. But it will not define us when it happens. And it will not hold us back from our task that we have been given. Because now there is a resurrection power that is welling up in the midst of our crucifixions. There's a peace that is seeping through our fear and carrying us through it. There's an abundance that is sustaining us when all others can see, or all that we can see, is lack. We have the ability in Christ, by the power of the Spirit he has given, to walk as he walked, through fear, but not in fear. This is what I found symbolized in my journey with Mr. Buck. Because those moments of dread of what could happen were quickly replaced by what did happen. Because just as Mr. Buck reached the top of the barn, the long ladder slipped from my grip, and down he came with a bang on the truck bed. My first thought, of course, is that I had killed him. But as he turned over, I realized that the actual worst-case scenario had happened. I had disappointed him. As only Mr. Buck could, he slowly drawled out, "I thought I told you to hold the ladder." It was a reproach, no doubt, but even in my adrenaline, I could sense a gentleness in it, a compassion for my weakness. And in the days and months and years that followed that day, that gentleness and compassion began to birth in me a freedom. Because the worst had happened. I'd already dropped him from the roof. And the world didn't end. He kept pursuing, and I started responding. Began to take off the locks and kept walking into relationship. And now those memories of working with him in the hayfield or with the cattle are some of the most precious to me of growing up. I'll never meet someone quite like that again. It isn't true that there's nothing to fear. There are all kinds of things worth fearing. But we need not stay captive to our fear. We need not stay behind our locked doors, friends. Because the resurrected Christ, by the power of the Spirit, meets us in that fear. And with compassion and gentleness, he gives us what we need to walk through those fears. And into a shalom that he has promised us, a resurrection abundance where what could happen or what has happened does not have the last word. Because there's a new word that is breaking in. Shalom. Let's pray. Jesus, we spend far more of our lives managing our fear than we care to admit. Trying to make sure all the doors are locked, that we're as safe as we can possibly be. I pray that this morning you would break through those doors. Come in your resurrection power and meet us right where we are. Speak those words of peace over us. And invite us to walk back through that door with you. May we have courage to follow wherever you lead. Even if what we fear does come upon us, help us trust that it does not have the last word. Amen.
stand and confess our faith in this God who is our peace in the words of the Nicene Creed. Together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Please join me in the prayers of the people. Feel free to lift up your prayers during the pause between each section. Father, fill us with your Holy Spirit and unite us with your heart in these prayers, that they would bring a deepening of your good works in us and through us. Father, you are good, and every gift comes from you. We celebrate and wonder at your wisdom and the mystery of your works. Open our eyes to see all the ways that you lavish us with your care. Father, you sent Jesus, our fierce and kind Redeemer, to weave us together as a family in your name and for your glory. Strengthen and accrue around the world and open our eyes to see our part in your body. Father, we celebrate that you sought us and invited us into your kingdom. May we remember the joy of turning from dark to light. Fill us with your love for those who are trapped in darkness. Jesus, call them by name. Father, you rule over every nation and determine the times and boundaries of each person's dwelling place. May each nation live in the purposes you design and bring an end to oppression and violence.
Gardens to grow again, for hope to be rebirthed, for contentment to spring. Have mercy.
Father, we know that affliction prompts our deepest questions about your goodness, and that no one escapes pain in body, mind, or spirit. We ask that those who are suffering be deeply blessed with the fullness of life that comes from you. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Please kneel if you are able. Together. Almighty Father, Creator of all, you marvelously made us in your image, but we have corrupted ourselves and damaged your likeness by rejecting your love and hurting our neighbors. We do wrong and neglect to do right. We are sincerely sorry and repent of our sins. Cleanse us and forgive us by the sacrifice of your Son. Remake us in the likeness of his resurrection and lead us by your Spirit. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our victorious Lord. Amen.
Please stand. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, the shalom of the Lord be always with you. Greet one another with signs of the peace that he has given us. All things come from you, O Lord. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. You may be seated as the baskets are being passed. Wanted to give a thanksgiving for our Lenten almsgiving project one more time. We've never done anything like this before, like a Lenten giving focus here at IAC. And we did so trying to support our ministry for welcoming the strangers here in Colorado Springs, specifically refugees and immigrants. And I'm so thankful to say that we raised about $27,000 to support that ministry. That's going to go to all kinds of things. We will give updates as that kind of money is going out. One of the things is our Nomad student ministry. Tomorrow night is going to be packing supplies for refugee and immigrant families in District 2. We were specifically asked to do that by District 2 through the 'Cause I Love You group here in Colorado Springs, and they're going to be participating in that tomorrow night, but there are going to be lots more opportunities going forward. We are so thankful that God is using us in this way, and so thankful for your generosity in giving to that so freely. We have been strangers, and God has welcomed us into his family. What a gift to be able to offer a tangible reflection of that to others. Let's stand and come to the table.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
However you have come this morning, fears, anger, confusion, frustration, Jesus' invitation is the same. He knows how we come, and He invites us, come to me. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and our delight to give You thanks and praise. Great Father, living God, supreme over the world, Creator, Provider, Savior, and Giver. From a wandering nomad, You created Your family. For a burdened people, You raised up a leader. For a confused nation, You chose a king. For a rebellious crowd, You sent Your prophets. In these last days, You have sent us Your Son, Your perfect image, bringing Your kingdom, revealing Your will, dying, rising, reigning, remaking Your people for Yourself. Through Him, You have poured out Your Holy Spirit, filling us with light and life. He was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By His grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for Him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim Your great and glorious name, forever praising You and singing. Almighty God, owner of all things, we thank You for giving us Your only Son to die on the cross for us who owe You everything. Pour out Your refreshing on us as we remember Him in the way He commanded through these gifts of Your creation. On the night that He was betrayed, He took bread. He gave You thanks. He broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is My body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." His Amen. Then, His body was broken for us. In the same way, after supper, He took the cup and gave You thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of Me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We are brothers and sisters through His blood.
We have died together. We will rise together.
We will live together.
Therefore, Heavenly Father, hear us as we celebrate this covenant with joy and await the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. He died in our place, making a full atonement for the sins of the whole world, the perfect sacrifice, once and for all. You accepted His offering by raising Him from death and granting Him great honor at Your right hand on high. Amen. Jesus is Lord. This is the feast of victory.
The Lamb who was slain has begun His reign.
Let us pray the prayer that the Lord Jesus has taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Christ is alive forever.
We are because he is.
Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. And feed on him by faith in your heart with much thanksgiving.
Friends, Jesus is with us this morning. He is among us, breaking through our walls and our locked doors to meet us right in the places we need to hear him. And that can be a scary thing. We've put up those locks on purpose. But I invite you this morning as you come to invite him into those places, that by this sign and symbol of the bread and wine, that he would make himself known to you in those places that you have been walled off. That he would meet you there and there would be freedom. Just want to remind you also, this is not an Anglican table. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you're a baptized follower of him, we invite you to come and receive of his goodness, to know that he is with you and that he is for you. We invite you to come.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward face toward you. Amen. 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 His favor be upon you in a thousand generations, in your family, in your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, in your family, in your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
Let us stand together and say our closing prayer. Together. Almighty God, eternal Father, we have sat at your feet, learned from your word, and eaten from your table. We give you thanks and praise for accepting us into your family. Send us out with your blessing to live and to witness for you in the power of your Spirit, through Jesus Christ, the firstborn of the dead. Amen. And because Jesus is our peace, all of our problems we send to the cross of Christ. All of our sins we send to the cross of Christ. All the devil's works we send to the cross of Christ. And all of our hopes we set on the risen Christ. Now receive this blessing. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We receive this blessing that we might be a blessing.
Amen. You may be seated. If the Penleys and the staff and those who were invited would come up on stage, we've now come to the time of sending out the Penleys and giving thanks to Christy for so much of the last 6 years. And Daniel's going to be sharing on behalf of all of us.
Things like this can be weird to do twice. But I'm actually really glad because twice still isn't enough to say these things. During nightly prayer time with my daughter, my 5-year-old Penelope, she often prays that people with money will give to the poor. And a few nights ago, she stopped and she said, "Like us." I was like, yeah, we have a lot. And I'm looking down at this giant mess of toys on the floor, and I pointed to her. I was like, yeah, look how much we have. We have so much treasure. And she said, yeah, and you know what? We are God's treasure. And I immediately texted Christy and Maddie because they are to blame for that comment. Your hope in God's deep love for us and your insatiable hunger for more of Jesus has rubbed off on my children and has rubbed off on us. Your heart will be deeply missed on staff team. And we cannot thank you enough for a lot of things. For your deep love for our children, the late nights, unseen, the personal time and resources that you poured into them, your sacrifice, your heart that you poured into them. For your influence on the hearts of parents at IAC as the primary spiritual influencers of their children. For your deep love for us, the staff, your volunteers and parents. Your awareness, your seeing us, seeing our hearts and loving us. Your sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. Your bravery in always being the first to be vulnerable and say something that is difficult to say on staff team. Your heart and your words calling us as a staff to freely open up our hearts to each other, drawing us together toward each other and toward Jesus. You're leading us to listen to the Spirit at all times, even when the plan is set and written down and we are in the middle of it. And when all things are finally made new, I really cannot wait to see the look on Jesus' face when he turns to you and it's finally time to talk about your last 6 years here at IAC and the hundreds of kids that know the love of God, know his love because of you.
Thank you. Thank you. I received this picture from Jennifer, who came to IAC. She's since moved. It's been in my living room. And I want IAC to have it. It is of Psalm 23, and it says, "The Lord is my shepherd." But I wrote a blessing for you that I want to pray over you. If you would just cup your hands like you're receiving a gift. May you know that your Heavenly Father loves you. He has claimed you as his own. You are his beloved. You are seen, not forgotten. You are loved and fought for. And I pray that God catches your heart in every way. May you trust him as he leads you into pastures. May you experience his active and powerful presence in your daily life. May you grow in the knowledge of his goodness and kindness and walk with him daily. Listen to his voice and lean in. He is good. We are all part of the Big C Church. We are all sheep and we need grace. May we trust the Good Shepherd. And may the Good Shepherd bless IAC and keep you. May you experience his smile over you, not because you've achieved his smile, but because he delights in his sheep. And may he turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Will you all stretch out your hands as we pray for Christine and her family? Jesus, thank you doesn't seem adequate for all that Christy, Paul, and their kids have done for our church. In this place where she has poured out herself, given of herself, and shared the gifts that you have given her to share, which she has done effortlessly and joyfully, with and for our kids and families, may we all be aware of what her heart has tended to and welcomed here, who it has nurtured and loved unconditionally, where it has offered blessing upon blessing, all for your glory. She has boldly given her time and her heart. She has sacrificed and she has served selflessly. May she and her family always know how they are loved and adored by you, Jesus, and by this church family. May she always know the seeds she has planted and cultivated so intentionally, that they will always be remembered, and our gratitude for this work runs so deep, deeper than words can adequately express. As you continue to lead Christy and her family forward in the path you have marked out for them, may she dwell in your presence. May she continue to be filled with your gifts, your blessings, your wisdom, and your peace, and may she know your joy in full measure. Jesus, bless Christy and Paul and Alexander and Soren and Kira and Bree and Langham and London as they go and serve you. I'm so grateful we are all a part of your Big C Church, and we are part of your one large body doing your work, because they will all be deeply missed in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church, would you join me in singing? The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Would you appreciate Christy with me?
Amen. Thank you so much for being here with us today at IAC. It is a gift to be together in the beautiful and the hard things. If you're new here at IAC, if you're curious about who we are, why we do what we do, we have a welcome dinner that is coming up, a once-a-month welcome dinner that is coming up next week. We would love to have you join us at that if you never have before. You can sign up for that or also just get to know someone by walking down as we go out these doors to the left through the courtyard, which is the way we exit. There'll be a connections table on your way, and you can check in with somebody there and find out more about who we are and what we're up to. A couple things coming up. We are still in the midst of Easter season, so some things that are happening there. The Imagination, Trauma, and Faith class starts tonight. Moving help for one of our refugee families. We still need some help with that this Saturday. The Art and Faith group is gathering next Sunday, and the Daddy-Daughter Dance is coming up on May 7th. You can find out more about any of that at springsiac.org/register. A couple larger pieces. One is that our mission team, who kind of coordinates all of our ministry to refugees and immigrants and missionary supports. We support about 30 missionaries here at IAC. Gathered up and shepherded by the mission team. And they are having a come and get to know the team, and also if you're interested in participating to come to this. So next Sunday at 9:45 a.m., you can sign up for this at springsic.org/register. If you're interested in any of those things, finding out more, they would love to let you know more about that. Coming up on May 7th is our Umaganda Day. Umaganda is a Kinyarwandan word. We are in an Anglican church plant from the Anglican Church of Rwanda, and so we've been shaped and formed by them in many ways. One of the ways we kind of pay tribute to that is through Umaganda Day. Once a month in Rwanda, they have what they call a coming together, an Umaganda, where they do service for those either someone that is in that geographic area. Everyone all across the country does it. So imagine like all of America getting together in its zip codes to do some kind of project. It's that kind of idea. We try to press into that here at IAC by doing a couple of these days a year. Umaganda Day, we call it, is the one in the spring. There are all kinds of projects, places to serve IACers and those outside IAC across town. After we're done, we're going to be gathering at Boddington Park in Monument Valley Park for ice cream and a bring your lunch picnic. It's a really beautiful day. You can find out more and sign up for the project that fits you and your household at springsic.org/register. And then finally, Hope Explored is starting not tomorrow, but one Monday away on May the 2nd. Hope Explored is a three-week conversation on life's really big questions. It's a safe place to bring questions or doubts. It's a place where if you are doubting or questioning, what does all this mean? What is Christianity all about? What is life all about? Or you know someone who is, and you'd like to come with them and bring them along. We would love to have you at this. You can find out more at springsic.org/hope specifically. And I just do want to encourage us in this Easter season, there is hope. There is always hope. There is always possibility, inevitability in the age to come, and possibility here in this age for Christ to break in. May we see him wherever we are today as we are sent back out into the world. Please stand.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! Sing the mercies of our King and with trembling. Children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood. bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a father who will never let them go. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. Now I sing. All our sorrows Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. When you cry to him, he hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice in the midst of suffering. He will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice.
Hallelujah. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We invite you to follow the clergy out to the courtyard to hang out there.
Rejoice. Come and lift your hands and raise. Mercies of your King, and with